instead of just asking the question, does a system have periodic solutions, we want to ask something quantitative about what's the shape and period of the periodic solution, maybe even something quantitative about what the waveform looks like. So if you were to look at X as a function of time, what would it look like? And especially for a type of system that's called relaxation oscillation. So this is section 7.5 of Strogatz. These are called relaxation oscillations because there's, say, stress that's accumulated during a slow buildup, and then it's relaxed during a sudden change. So think of an earthquake. Slowly over time, two plates are building up stress, and then it's released quickly in a burst of energy that shakes the ground. That's an example of a stick-slip oscillation. You also get the same thing with a bowed violin string. You get this in other situations as well, including circuits. So the van der Pol equation shows relaxation oscillations, and that's what we're going to use as an example to consider. So the van der Pol equation, we've seen it before. It's written this way. There's this nonlinear term, and we'll look in the strongly nonlinear limit. Strongly nonlinear limit means that this term is very important. So mu, much greater than one. Now, the usual way that we've written equations like this that are second order is we write them in a first order form of, we'll say that we'll define y is x dot, and then we'll write y dot equals something. We're not going to do that this time. So we're not going to use the usual phase plane variables. We're going to use, in some sense, it's a tricky transformation, and it's due to Leonard. So we'll use the Leonard transformation. And the advantage of this is that it causes the limit cycle to approach a constant shape as mu goes to infinity. And we'll make use of null clines as well. How does this work? Well, first, we'll look at the first two terms of the van der Pol equation. So I want you to look at this. X double dot plus mu x squared minus one x dot. This can be written as the total derivative of x dot plus mu 1/3 x cubed minus x. And hopefully you could see that. You take the derivative of x dot, you'll get x double dot. You take the derivative of this, and you'll pick up a overall x dot, and you'll get this x squared minus one. So that's interesting to notice. It sort of suggests this function means something here. So we'll define this as f, capital F of x. We'll define a new variable w that equals this thing inside the derivative. W equals x dot plus mu f, which is a function of x. So if we do that, then what is the van der Pol equation? I'll just write it this way, the VDP equation. This is w dot is this part up here. So that means it equals negative x. So this is actually a system of ODEs, first order system of ODEs. We could use that and then use this. It's kind of weird. The van der Pol equation is equivalent to x dot equals w minus mu f of x. And w dot equals negative x. So that's a weird transformation. And what can we do here? Well, let's look at null clines of this system, the variables x and w. Let's look at the x dot equals zero null cline. So x dot equals zero gives us w is mu fx. And what is f of x? It's this cubic thing. So it'll look like something like this. That's x dot equals zero. So if x dot equals zero, that means that along here and just like before, or draw lines, right? If x dot equals zero, that means y dot is likely non-zero. We don't know exactly what this is going to be. And the w dot equals zero implies that x equals zero, the w axis. So along the w axis, things are moving only horizontally. We don't know exactly which way yet. But all we have to do is pick one point, and then that'll figure things out for us. So it turns out that think of large W, things will be moving this way, things will be moving that way, and we've got a situation like that for the null clines. It's useful to look at some of these important, these critical points of F. So if we look at what's this point here, this point is actually at, if you look at the peak of that, that's at -1, x equals -1, but it's at 2/3 mu. And over here, this point is at 1 and -2/3 mu. We'll also define, if we look at a point over here, it's twice as far away. That's 2 and 2/3 mu. And then down here, here's -2 and -2/3 mu. And we'll label those points. Maybe we'll call this point, maybe starting from up here, here's A, here's B, here's C, and here's D. And something that you can notice about this is the, remember, mu is large. Mu is large. Very, very large. Much, much greater than one. Which means things are not to scale the way that I've plotted them here. In the x-axis, things are, kind of interesting things are happening between -2 and 2. But since mu is very large, the w-axis is stretched out. These things are, at 2/3 of a billion and -2/3 of a billion. So this sort of suggests we should do another change of variables so that we have things in more or less equal proportions. So another change of variables. We basically want to reduce the size of the w direction. So we will write things this way. W divided by mu, and that should take care of it. Now, when we do that, it changes our ODEs. What'll we get? We'll get x dot equals, we get an overall, get mu y minus f of x, and then y dot is -1/μx. So these are the variables that we'll use. And let me give you an idea of what's going on. So in these variables, x and y, y equals f of x is still going to give us that cubic looking thing. We've still got our points, these special points, what I call them, A, B, C, D. And now remember, mu is large. Mu is very large, but now it's like the coordinates are to scale. Like this is 2 and 2/3. This is 1 and -2/3. So everything's about order one. It'll aid in interpretation later. This is -2 and -2/3. But what it means is off of the x dot equals 0 null cline, which is this curve, y equals f of x. Off of that, the x dot is very large. And by very large, I mean it's much larger than y dot. Y dot is -1/μ. So think of 1/1 billion. And y dot is close to 0 everywhere. I mean, it's not quite 0, right? Along the x dot equals 0 null cline, things are going down. Or going up, depending on where we are, right? And then almost everywhere else, things are going along the x direction very, very fast. So we might even put, double arrows to show what's happening. There's just double arrows. And then down here, what's going on? Double arrows, double arrows. So what is happening here, if we were to start with some initial condition like this point, what's it going to do? It's going to quickly move to the right, and then it'll hit this null cline or close to the null cline. And then it'll slowly crawl downward. Like you might be saying, well, why is that? On the other side of this null cline, things are moving quickly that way. So everything's kind of collapsing to close to this null cline. I mean, same thing over here. Things are going that way. So if you want above the curve, y equals f of x, things are moving to the right. And below it, they're moving to the left. So this trajectory will kind of hit near the null cline, and then it'll move slowly. It'll slowly ooze until it gets to this point where it'll then quickly go to the left till it hits this point C on the other part of this null cline. And then again, slowly ooze upward, hitting D, and then quickly go to the right, hitting A. And then it keeps going on that cycle. And whether we started inside or started somewhere else, but if I started, you know, up here, I would quickly go to this null cline and then ooze and then rejoin what appears to be a limit cycle. And right, because of our rescaling, the limit cycle looks the same as mu goes to infinity. Because we're thinking of mu very large. We're not exactly on the null cline, but we're close to it. We could try a numerical example of this. And I won't choose mu of a billion. I'll try mu of 10. Here's the phase portrait. Here's the ODEs. Right, using our new x and y variables. And if you look at the vector fields and you see things are mostly just moving horizontally almost everywhere. Let's just start with an initial condition. Oh, what do you know? It's doing what we thought. It looks like things are settling down to a limit cycle here. Now, if we want to know the time scale, that's separate. Let's just plot a few more just so we're convinced. Okay. Wherever we go, we're hitting basically that null cline and then just going into this oscillation. It looks a bit like if we, a hysteresis curve with two saddle nodes. There may be a connection. I don't know. If we wanted to know something about the waveform, so how x is changing with time, think of what's going on here. The speed in the x direction going from D to A, that's going a distance of order one. So distance is, I'll just write it this way. It's about three, but you know, it's order one. And our speed is about mu. Speed is order mu. So we'll cross that gap in one over mu. Now going from A to B, that's again a distance of order one, but the speed is about one over mu. So the time it takes is of order mu. So when we put all this together, what will we see? Let's plot, you know, x versus time. We'd have the same sort of behavior as we go from B to C and C to D. So if we, let's start at point A, what we'll find is x decreases. And then it almost instantaneously, but actually very quickly, once we've hit point B, we get to C, and then it's slowly moving yet again upward till we get to D. And then almost instantaneously, but not quite, we get back to A. So we get this pattern. It looks a bit like a sawtooth, and it keeps repeating. So for these segments, the time here is of order mu. And for the tinier segments, it's order one over mu. So you can get some qualitative info about things as well. That phase plane plotter I have, it doesn't show x versus time, but I think there, if you would do it in MATLAB, you would see this. So that's it for today.